In the early days of computing, programmers needed to be very sure about the data they were operating on. If an operation was fed a number when it was expecting a letter, a character, at best you might get a garbled response, and at worst, you could break the system, maybe even physically. Now, the low level of coding, yeah, that's still true, but these days we have programming languages where we don't always need to be so rigorous in defining the data, and we can let the computer figure it out. But for something that seems so technical, this can be controversial. When you write a computer program, you use variables, which are basically just labeled buckets of memory. Inside that bucket is some data, and you can change it, you can vary it, hence variable. I know it's a massive simplification, but computer memory is a bit like an enormous rack of switches storing ones and zeros that represent other things like letters and numbers. But if we look into a region of memory, there is nothing in there to indicate what those ones and zeros are actually representing. So in the code, we declare that the variable is a particular type. What's contained in that variable, in that bucket? It's an integer. What's in that one? It's a string of characters. And that tells the computer how to interpret those ones and zeros in memory. The types that you get to use can differ a bit between languages, but in general, you will at least have integer or int. That's a whole number that can't have anything after the decimal point, and those are extremely useful for storing things like the number of times you've looped through some code, or how many points your player has clocked up, or how many pennies there are in someone's account. Then you've got character, or char. These are letters, numbers, punctuation, and white spaces, like the space between words and instructions to start a new line. And in most high-level languages, you'll probably be using a string instead, which is just a string of characters. Then you've got Boolean, or bool, named after George Boole, an English mathematician. That's very simple. It's true or false. A Boolean only contains either a zero or a one, a yes or a no, a no or a yes, nothing more. Then there's floating point numbers, or floats. Floats are complicated and messy in a whole other video, but in short, they let you store numbers with decimals, although you might lose a very small bit of precision as you do it. There are others, other types, in a lot of languages. I know it's more complicated than this, but this is just the basics. So, most languages use explicit type declaration. So when you declare a variable, when you set up that bucket, you have to also declare its type. So X is an integer. It can only hold integers, and right now that integer is 2. But in some languages, including some popular ones that people tend to get started with and that I like, you don't need to actually declare that. It just gets figured out from your code. That's called implicit declaration. So in JavaScript, you can just type x equals 1.5, and it'll know that's a number. Put the 1.5 in quotes, and it'll go, it's a string. So okay, it's storing 1.5 and 1.5 as different ones and zeros. Why does that matter? Well, in JavaScript, the plus sign means two different things. It's the addition operator for adding two numbers together, but it's also the concatenation operator for combining two strings together. So if x is 1.5, you ask for x plus x, it returns 3. But if either of those x's is 1.5 a string, it'll return that. And that's called typecasting, converting from one data type to another. Sometimes some languages require the programmer to explicitly request the conversion in code. Other languages, like JavaScript there, do it automatically. JavaScript is referred to as having weak typing as opposed to strong typing, and it's weak because even if that 1.5 is a string and you ask for it multiplied by 2, it'll return 3. And like the plus sign, that asterisk can only mean multiply, so it can only handle an integer or a floating point number. Give it a string, though, and it won't throw an error like a strongly typed language would. It'll just convert it for you on the fly. Really convenient, really easy to program with. Really easy to accidentally screw things up and create a bug that'll take you hours to track down. Or worse, create a bug that you don't even notice until much, much later. In a lot of languages, you can also cast to and from Boolean values, which is called truthiness. And experienced programmers who are watching this may already be grimacing. Truthiness is a great shorthand. If you convert an empty string to a Boolean, it generally comes out as false. Anything else, true. So you can just test for an empty string with if x. But that also means that in JavaScript, you can ask for true plus true, and it'll tell you that the answer to that is 2. Because when you cast true to a number, you get 1. In PHP, a language notable for many questionable design decisions, even a string with just a single zero in it will get converted to a Boolean false. There's a special case just for that string, which can cause a lot of unexpected bugs. Now, there is a workaround for that in loosely typed languages. Normally, if you want to compare two variables, you use two equals signs like this. You can't use a single one because that's used for assigning variables. I have been coding for about 30 years and I still absentmindedly screw that up sometimes. Now, if you ask if 1.5 is equal to 1.5 with two equals signs in JavaScript or PHP, you'll get true. But if you add a third equals sign, then you are asking for strict equality. If the data types don't match, any comparison will automatically fail. So why is all this controversial? Well, languages like JavaScript and PHP can get a bad reputation because they use weak typing. If you see yourself as a real programmer, and I'm using that sarcastically, but if you see yourself as the kind of programmer where you are in control of everything, then yeah, you can see that weak typing is like training wheels. It's something that introduces sloppy coding practices and bugs and shorthand, and that's not unfair. But weak typing also makes programming easier to learn and easier to do. It can reduce frustration and just make programmers' lives easier. It is a trade-off, even if it is a controversial one. This series of The Basics is sponsored by Dashlane, the password manager. It's kind of obvious that passwords are more secure the longer they are, but it can be difficult to get an intuitive sense of just how much more secure. So, let's say you've signed up to Dashlane and now you're able to use long, complicated, symbol-filled passwords everywhere because Dashlane remembers, synchronizes, and autofills them for you. How much more secure are those passwords? Well, let's do the maths. The characters that most websites tend to accept for passwords are uppercase and lowercase letters, numbers, and let's say 30 punctuation marks. That's 92 characters. There's an argument that you should be allowed to use any Unicode character in a password, but it is definitely an argument, so let's limit it to those 92 characters. First, because we're using random characters, we can ignore word lists that make password cracking orders of magnitude easier by guessing dictionary words first, including like using an exclamation mark instead of a one or deliberately swapping a couple of letters. Those tricks don't work here. Now, let's say that an attacker is able to test a billion possible passwords every single second. It's not unreasonable if the encryption is weak and their computer is fast. If you have a 6-character password, it will take them at most about 10 minutes to try every single possible one of the 606 billion combinations. But every letter you add multiplies that time by 92. 7 characters works out to 15 and a half hours. 8 characters, about 2 months. 9 characters, 14 years. 10 characters, more than a millennium. 11 characters is 100,000 years. By the time you've got to 15 characters, it's about 1,000 times longer than the universe has existed. Long, complicated, random passwords aren't a cure-all, but they're certainly better than the alternative. And to help you with them, dashlane.com/tomscott for a 30-day free trial of Dashlane Premium, which includes unlimited password storage and sync, plus a load of other features. And if you like it, you can use the code TOMSCOTT for 10% off.